That first 4 to 6 weeks after birth is the most critical time period for fawns, because if they can get past 4 to 6 weeks, their survival rate goes up tremendously. Because that first month to a month and a half is the time that if there's predators in the area, they are most susceptible to those. The reason is that when fawns are born, they are hiders, which means their mother will send them off to hide. And for the first week of life, they will literally lay there. They can slow their heart rate down if a predator comes near, but they're programmed to just hide, not to run. So for those first few days to a week, it's actually very easy to pick them off. You literally can just go up and grab them. That's why it is so important to have that good cover to provide them all the protection possible to make it through those first few weeks of life. Then at that point, they can outrun most predators that are after them anyway. So the first 4 to 6 weeks is by far the most crucial time period for fawn survival. Some people say, you know, that fawns don't have any scent and that's how they avoid predators. And that's not true. Fawns do have a scent. That's how their mother identifies them. However, they just have less scent than adults, which gives them a little bit of extra protection against predators. And in fact, day-old fawns will even rub urinate. We often think of mature bucks as doing the rub urinating, but does will actually do that. Fawns will do that. They are putting more scent on themselves to help others identify them for that unique smell. That's how their mothers identify them. That's how other deer identify them. So the old myth that, that fawns don't have a scent is absolutely just that. It's just a myth. When a fawn is first born, the mother doesn't keep her with it. She actually will send it out and have it hide because it has less scent than she does. And by sending it out to hide, there's less likely that she will attract a predator that can take it to the fawn. So she knows the approximate area her fawn or fawns are, but she doesn't know the exact spot. What she will do is she will feed them 3 to 4 times during the day and then send them out to hide. She's generally in an area nearby, but she doesn't stay right with them. What she will do then once the next feeding session is she will go to the general area, call to them. The fawn or fawns will get up and they bed separately for the first few weeks of life, come to her. She will then go ahead and feed them again. And one of the coolest things about this is that to ensure that she gives them the best protection possible, while she's feeding them, she actually will stimulate them to urinate and defecate. And this is why does should be absolute mothers of the year. By licking their genital regions, they will urinate and defecate. She will then eat that. And now part of this is, fawns for about the first month of life cannot urinate by themselves. And this is a predation survival mechanism. That way they're not putting scent where they are to lure a predator to them. So that's part of it, because then once the mother does this, she will actually eat that urine and feces to keep it out of the environment. So part of it is from a predation standpoint, but the other part is a nutrition standpoint. Any bacteria that's in that fawn's body that may be giving it problems, as she eats that, it goes through her body. She can then develop antibodies against that bacteria, put them into her milk, and then feed them back to that fawn to help make sure that it has the absolute best chance of survival. So that's why we like to say that the white-tailed does are the absolute mothers of the year. With regard to how many fawns a doe have, usually first-time mothers, those does that were 1.5 years old when they were bred, they typically give birth to single fawns. However, once does are 2.5 and older, they almost always give birth to twin fawns. Now, it doesn't mean that both of those fawns are gonna survive to be recruited into the deer herd. Some will get eaten by predators, some die to disease, etc. But twin fawns is very much the norm for healthy deer. Occasionally, you'll see triplets. It's pretty rare though, even in deer herds with really high quality habitat, and then does that have four or more are almost not heard of at all. Now, there are instances where they will have a doe that got hit by a car or shot by a hunter that had four fetuses inside it that were developing, but there are no known cases of a doe actually giving birth and then raising four fawns. So, poor situations, one fawn, good healthy situations, they almost always will give birth to twins. Fawn survival rates can vary widely depending on the quality of the habitat that they come from, as well as the experience of the mother. You know, we like to think that the does have a lot of fawns, so there's all kinds of fawns on the landscape. But the reality of it is, not all fetuses will become a fawn, and then not all fawns live to be about 6 months of age and be recruited into the deer herd. Now, we blame a lot of this on predators, and certainly bears and bobcats and coyotes kill a lot of fawns during the course of the year. But across the United States, the average survival rate is only around 50% from all of the fawns that hit the ground in the spring to make it to that fall's hunting season. And there's some really cool research out of Delaware, a state that doesn't have any fawn predators like coyotes and bobcats and bears, that we see very similar survival rates there to places like Pennsylvania and others that do have a lot of predators. So what this means is there's a lot of fawns that are hitting the ground in the spring that are programmed to die anyway, to disease, starvation, predation, etc. So think of all the fawns that are alive in May or June or July. We know best case scenario, only about half of them are going to be around opening day of deer season in the fall. Lots of things out there that are going to eat fawns, bears and bobcats and coyotes and some other predators. But what we do know is that areas that have poor quality habitat, meaning the does aren't as healthy or there's not as good fawning cover, they can take a much higher percentage of those fawns. So even if we have great habitat, they're still going to get some. But as managers, it's absolutely in our best interest to make sure that we feed those does as good as we can through good high quality habitat and then provide enough cover to give those fawns the best chance of survival. Now, there's some pretty neat research that shows that predation rates in forested areas are actually higher than in agricultural areas. So what we mean is we get into a bunch of these ag places where we have agriculture and early successional vegetation and forest, kind of all of this habitat meshing together, fawn survival rates can be much higher than in more forested areas where we tend to not have as good cover and certainly not as high quality forage in almost all cases. From a fawning cover standpoint, it's very important to have good cover spread throughout a property. That's way more important than having just a whole bunch of really good in one block. And the reason being that the only time of the year that deer are territorial is during the fawning season. And it's not bucks, it's the does. They become very territorial and will kick other does out of their area. What this means is the dominant does tend to get the best fawning cover. Hence, their fawns have the best chance of survival. And then as you go down the pecking order, at the bottom of that, those does have the worst fawning cover. So if you have some areas that are really, really good and others that are really, really bad, you have a lot of fawns that are starting off life at a big disadvantage. It's much more important to do a good job managing fawning cover and providing pieces or blocks of that throughout a property, because then you can allow a much higher number of the does using that property to have access to good fawning cover and thereby increase fawn survival on that property.